Telstra's plan to shrink to grow has failed to win over shareholders. The stocks plunged to a fresh seven-year low as analysts downgraded the company, not convinced slashing $1 billion and a quarter of the workforce will deliver an edge in a highly competitive market. And there are warnings appeasing shareholders by slashing costs could come at the expense of much-needed innovation. The RBA governor has recently weighed in, saying firms that are not able to innovate and take advantage of new technologies quickly are slipping behind and they feel under pressure. As a way of remaining competitive, many of these firms are responding by having a very strong focus on cost control. And there's already clear evidence Australia is lagging behind in the innovation stakes. The country's youngest top five company was founded more than a century ago. That compares to the Gen X top five global companies all created after 1975. Adrian Turner spent 18 years in Silicon Valley and is the CEO of the CSIRO's data innovation network, Data 61. I spoke to him earlier. Adrian Turner, welcome to The Business.
Thank you.
Now, we heard the RBA governor say that a number of Australian firms just are not ready to tackle the future, so they're cutting fat out of their businesses to shore up profitability, and that's feeding into low wages growth. Just how agile is corporate Australia?
So the first thing to recognise here is that we're in the midst of a massive disruption as ICT and digital technologies wash over every industry. And a lot of the focus has been applying that technology for productivity improvements. But what a lot of the country seems to be missing is that it's the structural changes to industries that are going to have the biggest impact and the lasting impact. So as a country, I think we've got more to do. But the good news is we have incredible talent and particularly R&D capability in the country to go after the opportunity.
So at the moment, Australia is still a lucky country.
Yes, it is. If you look at our reliance on traditional industries, I think it's order of magnitude 3% of the ASX are ICT companies. If you contrast that with the US, 23% of the S&P 500 are tech companies.
And you point to the composition of the top companies in Australia, which are predominantly banks and miners, whereas the FANG companies, if you like, the Facebook, Alphabet, Amazon type companies dominate the top corporates in America.
That's right, and also the world. So if you look at seven of the top 10 companies in the world by market capitalization right now, they're all platform or data-driven companies. The other thing that's interesting to note is if you look at Australia's top five companies by market capitalization, the youngest was founded in 1911. If you look at the top five companies in the world, they were all started after 1975.
So we're really lagging then?
Look, we are lagging. And if you look at Australia's use of digital technology for productivity, so there's two ways to think about it. One is how to drive productivity through existing business and how to create and apply it to new industry creation. And it's really the latter that we're lagging in. So we're pretty good at adopting technology and using it for productivity gains. But Australian innovation active firms, so these are the companies that are doing new things, and there's different types of innovation, but they're innovating. Only 8% of those companies are taking their innovations to the world. So we're very, very focused domestically and not thinking globally enough from day one with our innovations.
What areas should we be in Australia then?
So Australia has enormous strength in industries like agriculture, healthcare, minerals, and the opportunity is applying digital to those industries. We call it cyber-physical systems, or internally we call it digital plus domain. And so you think about precision agriculture, and more specifically, you think about Australia exporting premium food products to the rest of the world. We want to be able to attest to the provenance of the food. So supply chain integrity and provenance as it relates to food is a huge opportunity for this country. Precision health and wellness. So ultimately using data analytics and digital technologies to be able to help people manage their health rather than having the current crisis-driven, interrupt-driven system will both provide better experience but also take cost out of the system for the country.
And is Australia investing enough in research and development, for example, to achieve these ends?
The piece, if you look at Australia, we've been very good at the R&D and the invention, and where we've tended to fall down is the commercialization. So the translation of that research into not just domestic products and services, but new to the world products and services. And that's our opportunity. And we think if we get this right over the next 10 years, it actually represents an $810 billion GDP opportunity for Australia.
You spent a lot of time in Silicon Valley in the US, so you have that experience. How optimistic are you that there is the potential in Australia that we could see global corporates like the Facebooks and the Amazons?
So I am. And if you look at the US and if you look at the Silicon Valley in particular, the first thing is we shouldn't be trying to replicate Silicon Valley. It's unique. And in some ways, I actually think that Silicon Valley has lost its way. We have incredible talent, we have incredible R&D capability, we have people that are good entrepreneurs. We see it in the mining sector and other sectors. We see it in the tech sector with companies like Seek, we see it with Atlassian. We can do it for sure. What we need to do is think global from day one. We need to move faster in this world we're moving to. It's all about time to scale. It's not about getting to market first, it's about getting to scale first. And so it's a different mindset that we need to have.
Are you getting a good response from corporate Australia with this message?
So what's interesting is the willingness to have the conversation. That's accelerating for us. And where it's accelerating is at the executive level and the board level. And I think it's for a couple of reasons. So if you look around the world, These data-driven companies are accelerating not only in scale, but they're starting to move into adjacent markets. The other thing is we've seen Amazon enter the domestic market. We saw NAB let go people, but then hire data scientists. And this announcement in the last days by Telstra to let people go, but also consolidate their product offering and really get clear about where they can drive scale to compete. All of this is driving the need for executives to understand how these disruptions are affecting their business. So our interest level has never been higher.
Adrian Turner, thank you for joining the business.
Thank you.